Okay, well, let's open our Bibles, please, to the book of 2 Thessalonians, chapter 1. And if you happen to need a Bible, our happy ushers will be more than glad to give you one if you'll just raise your hand up in the air so that they know you may need one. 2 Thessalonians, chapter 1. Let's stand together, please. I'd like to start, please, in verse 4, and we should, Lord willing, be able to finish this chapter. We're going through the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation. I do want to, as we like to welcome our internet congregation, wherever you may be, however many of you there are tuned in, we pray for God's blessing upon you, just as we pray for His blessing upon us here tonight. But 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, beginning in verse 5, which is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you also suffer, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give to you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power, when he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed. Therefore, we also pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling, and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness and the work of faith with power, that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, Father, we pray this same thing for ourselves, that you would count us worthy of the calling that you've given us. We pray that you would fulfill all the good pleasure of your goodness and the work of faith with power. We especially pray for the power of your Spirit. And we ask, Lord, that your name might be glorified in us and we in you, and all of this according to the grace of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So we pray for your blessing here tonight upon each one of us. And thank you for these beautiful songs which captivate our minds and our hearts and help bring us back to an eternal perspective. We appreciate being able to set aside the cares of the day and to catch our breath spiritually, as it were, to be encouraged, to be refreshed, to be redirected, to be guided, to be lifted up, to be patched up, if that's the need, and just generally to have your face smile upon us as we take this time of fellowship with you, Lord, and with one another. In Christ's name we pray, amen. You may be seated. Well, Paul was writing to the church in Thessalonica to encourage people just like you and I. And these were people who were facing persecution. And the persecution they were facing was because they had become Christians. And they were living in the midst of a society not unlike the one you and I live in. And they needed to be encouraged. And they also needed to be corrected on the subject of the day of the Lord or the coming judgment of God. There was some false teaching being brought into the church, and it was being attributed to Paul, and they were being told that the judgment of God had already begun, pointing to the persecution which was coming. And so they were confused, because earlier in his first letter, and when he was there, he had taught them how that the Lord was going to remove his church before the wrath of God came. But there were people coming in and teaching, and there was a letter that was apparently signed by Paul, which it was not, stating that the day of the Lord or the judgment of God had begun. And so he gets to that issue in the second chapter. But one of the interesting things that he also deals with in the third chapter, and there's only three chapters in this letter, is that the people who believed that the judgment of God was upon them, some of them thought, well, why should I do anything? Why should I keep working and so on if the end is coming? And so consequently, they had no money. And as a result of having no money, they were hungry. And as a result of being hungry, they started mooching off of their fellow believers. So Paul was writing, and he deals with that, which he had already dealt with in the first letter. He was writing to the moochers, if you will, there in Thessalonica, telling them, hey, if you don't work, you don't eat. Pretty eternal principle. But they were being persecuted, and if we just go back to verse 4 for a moment, he says in verse 4, so that we ourselves, and the we there would be not only Paul, but his two companions, Silvanus and Timothy, the team that he worked with. He said, for we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God. And the apostle, in using this word boast, I mentioned it last time, the word simply means that he could hold up the Thessalonians as an example of a good example of believers. That's quite a statement for him to be able to say to other Christians, you know, those people in Thessalonica, they are a real good example of what a Christian is. And he couldn't restrain himself, nor could Silvanus or Timothy. They were so thankful to God for the work God was doing in this city. And you and I, by the way, are also called to be an example. Do you remember when you were learning how to write? Now, I don't know if they still do it this way, but when I was learning how to write, which was just a couple of weeks ago, we had what was called tracing paper. So you could see through the tracing paper to the letters and the numbers. And so you learned how to hold your pencil and you traced the letters or the numbers. And you could see what was there. That was the example that you were to follow. And so Christ, of course, is our example, and God is seeking to conform us into the image of Christ, and we then become examples. And isn't it a blessing when you're with a group of believers and you're so impacted by these other people, you see Christ in them? And it affects you, and it causes you to want to be more godly. It causes you to want to follow Christ. And so we're all called to be examples one to another. And if you're a husband, you need to be a good example to your wife. If you're a wife, you need to be a good example to your husband, to your children. At your job, you need to be a good example of Christ. If you're a boss, if you're an employee, a church member, we're all called to be good examples. And so Paul said, we just think of you guys as such tremendous examples. And he says, So that we boast, so that we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God. And here were two of the things that he boasted about them of. And we covered this a little last week, but it's so central to the Christian life, and it was central to them. He was boasting of their patience and their faith. In all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure. So Paul was so proud of them. He told all the other churches about the patience or the endurance and the faithfulness in all the persecutions and hardships. So when he was speaking to other Christians who, by the way, were having their own problems, he would say, well, you know, these people over here, they're being persecuted, they're going through afflictions, but one of the things they're doing by the grace of God is they are enduring the trouble that they're going through. They're being patient in all of their troubles, and they're also demonstrating faithfulness, their faithfulness towards God, their perseverance in their faith. Warren Wiersbe says, not only can suffering help us to grow, but we can then help others to grow. And that's so true. Suffering has an effect upon us if we take it the right way, but then God will use us to help others and encourage others who are suffering. He went on to say, we are not to be cisterns or just repositories that receive and keep, like a big clay water container. He said, we're not just to receive what God gives us and hold on to it, but we're also to be channels that receive what God gives us, and then we share that with other people. The word faithfulness here, or the word faith, is actually the word faithfulness. And so the two go together. We reveal our faith in God by our faithfulness of life. And that's what these people were doing. They were showing that they really had faith in God by the faithfulness of their own life. They were faithful to the Lord. They were faithful to one another in spite of all the troubles that they endured. And of course, you know, and I know, that when troubles hit us, we want to run away. That's very normal. That's very natural. No one likes difficulty. But these people chose to remain, and that's what patience means. They chose to remain in spite of all the troubles. Greg Laurie once said many years ago that he read the quote of a pastor somewhere who was asking somebody, how are you doing? The person answered them and said, well, considering all the troubles I'm under, I guess I'm doing pretty well. And the pastor went on to talk about, well, you know, we need to be above those things. We need to not just see our life as being under these troubles, but we need to have faith in God, endure them, and live above them because of our faith in God. And when a person in difficulty forsakes the Lord, and that often happens, people get in trouble, they forsake the Lord, they forsake the church, they are showing that they either never have been born again or that their spiritual life is very weak. A true Christian who is growing will be faithful come what may. And Jesus talked about that in the parable of the sower, that when tribulation came and the cares of this life, that they stopped being fruitful. In fact, during World War II, when the enemy armies invaded North Africa, all of the missionaries in that area had to flee, and there was great concern over the churches that were left behind. You can imagine what's going to happen to the people. The pastors had to leave, but when the war ended and all the missionaries returned, they discovered strong, thriving churches, and the sufferings of war purified the church, and it helped strengthen the faith of the true believers. What an encouragement this was to the churches of the free world. And that's exactly what you see happening in the lives of people that you know who are going through difficulty, but they keep their faith in God. They keep their love towards one another. What happens is they grow. And so Paul was saying, you guys are a tremendous example. You have patience. You have faithfulness in all of your persecutions and all of your tribulations or your afflictions that you endure. All the hardships, all of the sufferings that they were going through. So in verse 5, Paul goes on, having referred now to that, their faithfulness, their patience, and all the trouble, he says, which is manifest or plain evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer. Or another way of looking at this would be this, that God will use this persecution to show his justice. In other words, it's plain evidence. Look what was done to the people of God. That their being persecuted was plain evidence of the righteous judgment and justice of God against those who were bringing this trouble to the people there in Thessalonica. So he says, which is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you also suffer. So no matter how difficult their circumstances were, these believers knew they had a glorious future, and in fact, their sufferings were evidence or a manifest token that God was righteous, that God was working out his great plan for them. And sometimes when we're suffering, what happens is we're prone to think that suffering proves God doesn't care. Isn't that true? When real hard times come, not a flat tire or your refrigerator goes out or, you know, that kind of stuff, but I'm talking about real serious stuff. One of the thoughts that really can grip you is, well, doesn't God care about me? If he did, why would he let these kinds of things happen to me? And of course, the devil is very quick to inject those thoughts into your mind. And we wind up thinking that God doesn't really care. We're prone to think that that suffering proves that he doesn't care, when in fact, it's just the opposite. Furthermore, the way we act in times of trials proves to others that God is at work. Look with me, please, to the book of Philippians, just to the left a little bit. Philippians chapter 1, I'd like to just develop this principle a little bit, that when the way we act in a time of trial proves that God is at work in our lives. Philippians chapter 1, verse 28 through 30. If you go back to verse 27, we'll get a running start at it. He says, only let your conduct or the way you live be worthy or in keeping of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me and now here to be in me. So these folks were going through these very, very difficult times. And back in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, if you'll go back there with me, please. He says in verse 5, which is manifest evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you also suffer, or God will use this persecution to show his justice and to make you worthy of his kingdom for which you are suffering. Jesus, one of the names of Jesus is that he was a man, the man of sorrows. He was a man acquainted with sorrows. And God uses our sorrows and our sufferings to develop our character. In verse 6, Paul says, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you. So, in God's justice, he's going to pay back the people that are persecuting you, is what he's saying. God is going to pay back. And that's just the way of the Lord. He recompenses, he pays back. He's going to recompense the affliction, he's saying. So since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. To pay back or to repay, recompense is the idea. God is going to repay with affliction those who trouble the people of God. It's just the way that it works. And it's also true that wicked people who persecute the godly don't always receive their just recompense in this life. It comes sometimes in the next. In fact, the apparent prosperity of the wicked and the difficulty of godly people have posed a problem for God's people down through the ages. Godly people who are going through trouble, they look at ungodly people and they wonder, how can they be so blessed? And look at me, I'm a godly man. Look at how wicked they are. And look at how blessed they are. I'm godly, and look at how much trouble I've got. It's been a problem that people have dealt with for ages. If you look in Psalm 73, the psalmist had this very same problem and devoted an entire psalm to it. I want to just read a few verses from Psalm 73, and it's affirming the principle that Paul is talking about here in 2 Thessalonians. You know, the idea is if the wicked are going to prosper, why live a godly life if all you're going to do is suffer? I mean, that's a question. If, hey, they've got it so easy, why should I even try to be godly if all I'm going to do is suffer? In Psalm 73, the psalmist says, truly God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart, but as for me... So he makes that blanket statement about God. He is good to Israel, or the people of God, to such as are pure in heart. That's a true statement. But he says, let me explain to you what happened to me. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. For I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no pangs of in their death, but their strength is firm. They're not in trouble as other men. Therefore, pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes bulge with abundance. They have more than heart could wish. They scoff and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens. They curse, and their tongues walk through the earth. They just boast. Therefore, his people return here, and waters of a full cup are drained by them. And they say, How does God know, and is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who are always at ease. They increase in riches. And then he says here in verse 13, a further expression of his deepest thoughts, surely I have cleansed my heart in vain, or I have kept my heart pure in vain. It's been really, you know, it hasn't paid off. And I've washed my hands in innocence, for all day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. All day long I've gone through trouble, and every day, every new morning. In verse 15, if I had said, I will speak thus, behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. When I thought to how to understand this, it was too painful for me. So he didn't want to really tell people what he was thinking, and he just couldn't put it all together. Why am I suffering? I've made my heart, I try to be pure. I try to say no to you. Oh, I'm not perfect, but I try to, you know, I'm not like them. I'm not given over to debauchery and all of that. Well, what's the point in putting off the flesh? What's the point in denying myself? I don't want to even tell people how I really feel. My feet are almost slipping. I'm unsteady in my faith. And then he says in verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God. So something happened when he went into the sanctuary of God. And that's why it's good for people to be in church. And that's why it's important for the leadership of the church to be those who are proclaiming the truth of God, teaching the truth of God. And as Pastor Chuck Smith once said from this very pulpit, when we dedicated this building, he taught out of Psalm 73. He said, it's important to always give the people an eternal perspective, because all week long they're out in the world suffering and going through difficulty. You remind them of where they're going. You show them the big picture. And of course, that's what happens when you come to church, a good church. You get straightened out, your thinking gets cleared up, you get reminded about, oh yeah. So the psalmist said, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end. Those people who appeared to have no trouble in this world, I understood what is going to happen to them at the end. And that's what Paul is developing over in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. He says in verse 18, describing what will happen to them, surely you set them in slippery places. You cast them down to destruction. Oh, how they are brought to desolation as in a moment. They are utterly consumed with terrors as a dream when one awakens. So, Lord, when you awake, you shall despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved and I was vexed in my mind. I was so foolish and ignorant. I was like a beast before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold me by my right hand. You will guide me with your counsel and afterward receive me up into glory. So the psalmist was having this trouble, but going into the house of God helped him out. And as Christians, we need to live with eternity in mind, because that is what is going to happen. Eternity is waiting for all of us. We're not just here for the moment. In fact, living with eternity's values in view is what makes our Christian life meaningful in this day and age. Today, we are walking by faith and not by sight. There's a story that illustrates this. It's the story of two farmers. One was a believer and the other was an atheist. And when harvest season came, the atheist taunted his believing neighbor because apparently God had not blessed him too much. The atheist's family had not been sick. His fields were rich with harvest, and he was sure to make a lot of money. He said to his believing friend, I thought you said it paid to believe in God and be a Christian. It does pay, replied the Christian, but God doesn't always pay his people in September. What kind of a future does the unbeliever face? That's what Paul is dealing with here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6. Since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation or affliction those who trouble you. That's what is coming to the unbeliever. Those are very dramatic words. Tribulation, vengeance, flaming fire, punishment, everlasting destruction. So he says he's going to repay them with tribulation, and he's going to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So the Christ-rejecting world will receive from God exactly what it gave to God's people. All of those who are against Christ and against the people of God, they're going to receive from God exactly what they've given to the people that they have persecuted. When God recompenses or repays, he pays in kind. There is a law of compensation that operates in human history. For example, Pharaoh tried to drown all the male babies born to the Jews. Do you remember that? And what happened to his own army in the Red Sea? They drowned, didn't they? He tried to drown all these babies, and God wound up having his army drowned in the Red Sea. How about Haman? He plotted to wipe out all the Jews, like ISIS. He wanted, and the Iranians wanted to wipe out all of the Jews. And he and his own sons wound up being wiped out. He built these gallows to hang Mordecai, and he wound up being hung on his own gallows, he and his sons. How about the advisors of King Darius who forced him to arrest Daniel and throw him into the lion's den, but later themselves were thrown into the lion's den? How about the unbelieving Jewish leaders who crucified Christ in order to save the nation and in a few short years saw their city destroyed and their nation scattered? So it is a righteous thing with God, it says in verse 6, to repay with tribulation those who trouble you. And to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. And when he is revealed from heaven, and this is not speaking of the rapture of the church, but the second coming, please notice the description here in verses 8 and 9. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So this will be following the rapture of the church, following the great tribulation period, when Christ returns in flaming fire. In fact, we're going to look at this, I think, in just a minute in Revelation. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God. You know, eternal life really means that you know God. Jesus himself said, this is life eternal, that you might know him. Before you came to Christ, you were without God. You didn't have a relationship with God. You knew about God, but you didn't know him personally. And so there, you were someone who did not know God. There will be people during the tribulation period who don't know him even in spite of all the trouble. And they do not obey the gospel. They, even though there will be these angels, these everlasting angels flying around through the heavens, even though two witnesses will be raised from the dead, even though there will be great manifestations of the power of God, there will be people who will refuse to obey the gospel, the good news of Christ. Imagine how powerful sin and rebellion is, that a person would refuse the forgiveness of God even after seeing all of these manifestations of power. In chapter 2, by the way, which will be in next week, part of the answer of how come they don't certainly has to do with the fact that they will be deluded and deceived by the Antichrist, the man of sin. It says in verse 9, these shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. So it is a righteous thing with God to judge sinners and condemn sinners. A holy God cannot leave sin unjudged. No, people who say, I can't believe that a loving God would judge sinners and send people to hell. They understand neither the holiness of God nor the awfulness of sin. While it is true that God is love, it is also true that God is light, and in his holiness, he must deal with sin. There was a Christian doctor who was trying to witness to this very moral woman who belonged to the church, but had denied the need for salvation. So she was rejecting the thought that you have to be born again, and she was rejecting the thought of future eternal punishment. And she said to the pastor, God loves me too much to condemn me, this lady would say. And she became a patient in the hospital, and this Christian doctor was trying to witness to her, and she would say to him, I just can't believe that God would make such a place as the lake of fire. And as she became ill and the diagnosis was cancer, an operation became necessary. And so the doctor said to her, he said, I wonder if I should really operate. I really love you too much to cut into you and give you pain. Doctor, said the patient, if you really loved me, you would do everything possible to save me. How can you permit this awful thing to remain in my body? It was easy then for him to explain what cancer is to the body, sin is to the world, and both must be dealt with radically and completely. Just as a physician cannot love health without hating disease and dealing with it, so God cannot love righteousness without hating it and judging it. The word vengeance here in verse 8 must not be confused with revenge. The purpose of vengeance is to satisfy God's holy law. The purpose of vengeance is to pacify a personal grudge. God doesn't hold a grudge against sinners. Quite contrary, he sent his only son to die for them, and he pleads with them to return to him. But if sinners prefer to know not God and obey not the gospel, there is nothing left for God to do but to judge them. And this judgment will take place when Christ returns. What is the worst punishment in hell? Because he talks about it. This passage states the real agony of those that go to hell. When you think, what is the worst part of hell? It is that they will be eternally separated from the Lord. Notice in verse 9, these shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. To understand how terrible a punishment this is, think about the consequences of being separated from God's presence. Just think about it. Judgment, when Christ comes back, non-believers will face a judgment that believers will not. There will be believers on the earth when Christ returns. At this judgment, non-believers will have all their deeds revealed before everyone. That's going to be quite a day. When God opens those books, the entire world will know all of the sins that a person has committed. And they will then be sentenced to spend eternity in the lake of fire. Revelation 20 actually speaks of that. We don't have the time to go there. So judgment is one thing that's going to happen. And then everlasting destruction in hell. Non-believers will be doomed to exist in unending torment with the devil and his demons. The torment that they will endure is described by Jesus as an unquenchable fire, an unquenchable eternal fire in Matthew. So non-believers will spend eternity not only separated from God, but in agony. And then there will be regret. Jesus used many parables to describe the kingdom of heaven, who would get into it and who would not. Those who don't get into the kingdom of heaven are pictured in a place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You know, when you see somebody weeping, but then when you see somebody gnashing their teeth, or if you've ever gnashed your teeth, I've gnashed mine a few times, you're really troubled, to say the least. Weeping and gnashing of teeth, their response will be the weeping and gnashing of their teeth is one of regret when they realize what they have will be missing out on for eternity. They'll be so filled with personal regret. I'll never see God. I'll never get out of here. You know, being in Iraq a few weeks ago in these IDP camp, internally displaced persons, citizens of Iraq in these camps in their own country, enclosed by barbed wire, rows and rows of tents, dirt roads. These people have no hope of ever getting out of there. They have no idea. It's not like, okay, we're just here for 90 days and pretty soon we'll get to go back home. ISIS came into their home, their villages, their towns, their cities. We weren't too far from Mosul that the ISIS took over. And the people had to flee for their lives. And so when you look into the eyes of these people, many of them have lost their family members. They're now in these IDP camps, and they have no idea of when they're going to get out. They will eventually get out someday, probably. But people who wind up in hell will never have to ask the question, when am I going to get out of here? Because they never will get out of there. And they're going to realize, I'm here because of what I did. I didn't know God. I could have known him. I rejected him. I didn't obey him. I didn't obey the gospel. The gospel is actually a command by God to come and receive the forgiveness of God. It's a gift. It's an invitation. But it's also a command. It's one you obey when Christ says to repent. It's not a suggestion. It's a command. He's saying, repent or perish. And then there's hopelessness. So judgment is one thing that unbelievers will experience. Everlasting destruction, regret, and then hopelessness. Because their punishment is everlasting, non-believers have no hope of their condition ever improving. I mean, the people in these camps do at least have that hope. We brought them some hope. Their lives improved for a day and little bits of what we were able to do for them. But in hell, people will have no hope of their condition ever getting any better. Their existence is not only one of agony, but of despair. Those who know Christ have much to gain, and that's what he's saying here, and those who do not know Christ have everything to lose. So back again in verse 6 and 7, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled, the believers, rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. God is going to provide rest, he's saying to you, Thessalonians, you who are being persecuted, and also for us, and we could say that to one another today. God is going to provide rest to you. He's going to bring judgment on the unbelievers. He's going to provide rest for you. And in his justice, he's going to pay back those who persecute you, and he's going to do it in this flaming fire. When Jesus appears from heaven, he's going to come with his mighty angels. You know, we always think of angels as being kind of soft-spoken and kind of easygoing and, you know, real gentle and made out of marshmallows or something. But they're mighty. And I'm sure with all the number of angels there are many who have different jobs. The Bible seems to indicate that we have angels who, they are ministering spirits sent forth to minister to those who are the heirs of salvation. The Bible says, be careful when you're entertaining a stranger. You might be entertaining an angel. You never know. So there isn't a whole lot said. Jesus referred to their angels when speaking of the little ones. We get this guardian angel concept. It's not very developed theologically in the Bible, but it's safe to say that angels are around us. In the Old Testament, they were revealed to one of God's people. And he said, well, there's more of them that are with us than that are with them, more of God's angels than these people who are out to get us. So when Jesus comes, he's going to come from heaven, where he is now, and he's going to come with his mighty angels. What a moment that's going to be. When God says, okay, it's time to go. He's waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. And you think of all the enemies during the tribulation period, all those who gather around the Antichrist, the final rebellion against God there at the end of the book of Revelation. Those are the enemies of God. All the hordes and multitudes of believers who will be martyred for their faith. I mean, martyrdom for our faith is something that just a few years ago here in America, we would read about but couldn't really relate to. Oh, yes, in the early days, the lions in the Colosseum and all of that, and you hear about it maybe distantly, but surely just in these last couple of years, we begin to hear and daily how throughout the world Christians are being martyred. And they're in Iraq. They're out to kill Christians. They find you. They'll demand that you denounce your faith or die or pay them money. They'll be happy to take your money. So you have a couple of options. During the tribulation period, there will be multitudes who will be like the Thessalonians, enduring the hardship of the Antichrist, all the plagues, the hardships of not eating, and how easy it would be if they would just renounce their faith. They will wind up being martyred. And so Christ will come when all of his enemies are made his footstool in flaming fire with mighty angels from heaven. and he'll be bringing judgment on those who don't know God and on those who refuse to obey the good news and of the Lord Jesus Christ. They will be punished, he's saying here, with eternal destruction, separated from the Lord and from his glorious power, never to see him. In verse 10, when he comes in that day, the second coming of Christ to the earth, when he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed. So when he comes on that day, he will receive glory from all his holy people. Imagine the living believers at the time of Christ's coming. What glory they will give to Christ. You think of those concentration camps during World War II of the Jews, and when they were, the Allies came and delivered them. They were so, how would you even describe their feelings towards their deliverers? Christ will be glorified among his people. He will receive glory from his holy people. He will receive praise from all who believe. Now, I know that at the rapture of the church, Christ is going to bring all who have believed with him. And he's going to take the living believers off the earth. When he comes back from heaven, he's also going to bring with him all those in heaven. Why? Because we're going to reign and rule with Christ. So we're going to be with him, viewing his coming again. In fact, it's worth looking at. Let's just turn to Revelation. Anything's worth looking at in the Bible, but since we're kind of talking about this, I want to show it to you. Revelation, it's in 19 and 20. It's actually in 19. Yeah, 19 verse 11. This is the coming of Christ. Revelation 19 verse 11. John is seeing all of this in advance. Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. Those are two other names of Jesus. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, that would be Christians, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. Just his word. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses, and of those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. And then I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone, and the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and the birds were all the birds were filled with their flesh. And then chapter 20 deals with the events that follow. So in verse 11, back in, or verse 10, back in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 11, there he says, verse 10, then when he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed. And Paul is saying, I'm so thrilled you guys have believed, and we should be thrilled with one another. You and I have believed in Jesus Christ. We're believers. So he closes this little section out with a prayer in verse 11 and 12. He says, therefore, we pray always for you. So we keep on praying for you is what he's saying. We also pray always for you. And here's what he prayed for, that God would count you worthy of this calling. That's one. And two, and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness and the work of faith with power. So several things there. He says, we keep on praying for you, and we're asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. That's a beautiful prayer that we can pray for ourselves or for our spouses, our children, that you and I would live a life worthy of God's call. You know, when I was a little boy and used to go spend the night down the street, our home was pretty rough at our home. And my dad would always say to me, I mean, I was just a little kid, second, third grade, he'd always say, now, Robert, say, don't you tell anybody anything about our family when you go down to spend the night down there. And, you know, that's a lot for a little kid to process, even though I was a genius at a young age. It was a lot for me to process, but I can remember even to this day not really being able to put all that together very precisely, but knowing, yeah, there's something wrong here, and yeah, you don't want anybody to know about it. My father was an alcoholic, and I remember one time he tried to cut my mother's head off with a big butcher knife and left a big scrape on the refrigerator, and I used to see that scrape all the time. So it was pretty rough around the Grenier home. And he would say to me, don't you tell anybody what goes on around here. And so I kind of knew that something is wrong here. And then I knew, okay, when I went down there, I don't tell anybody. Don't you tell anybody. But do you know what I did? I blabbed everything. No, I didn't. I kept my mouth shut. I didn't know any better. What my father was trying to present was a false view. He was presenting a false view, and he's saying, now look, I want you to live up to this view. Well, our Lord isn't presenting a false view. He is the truth. And God wants you and I to live a life worthy of the calling that we've been called with. You and I have been called to follow Jesus Christ. Not only does God not say, hey, don't tell anybody what goes on in our family, he says, you tell everybody what goes on in our family. And I want you to live a life that's worthy. You've been called out of darkness to follow Jesus Christ, to go to heaven. So while you're here, you live that life. So Paul says, we're praying for you and we're asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his calling. And so here we get a little peek into the fact that prayer is effective, prayer can bring power, prayer or power is needed to enable us to live for God the right way. We have a wonderful prayer meeting every Tuesday morning. It's a small little group, but I'll tell you, It's an important meeting, and I want you to know there are men here in this church that pray for you. They pray from the scriptures very specifically. And God can provide us with and so desperately wants us to have His power in our life. And that is so, he says in the middle part of verse 11, and fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness and the work of faith with power. He's saying, may He give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. May God empower you to do all the good things that you believe He's prompting you to do. I mean, we have so many things on our plate that God has put there. We're like triple-decker hamburgers all over the plate. We need God's power to accomplish these things. And Paul is insinuating here, we can't do the good things that God wants us to do apart from His power. You know this whole thing of pull yourself up by your bootstraps and God helps those who help themselves? That's in first something I don't know where in the Bible. That's not true. God helps those who can't help themselves. God wants to help you. God wants to help you in what your faith that He's given you is prompting you to do. You know, when my wife and I moved here, we're starting year 37 right now, this month, 37 years ago. Can you imagine? We believed that God was sending us to Visalia. We didn't know it was really called purgatory. He tricked us. Just kids, 37 years ago, but our faith was prompting us to come here, and God gave us the power to come here. I mean, we didn't know a single soul. But we were as happy as could be, just, hey, God sent us here. Here we are. And I have to tell you this little story. It's just so, shows how ignorant I was. I had the names of two people that Pastor Chuck gave me. He said, when you get to Visalia, he said, look these guys up. He said, they might be interested in what you're doing. I said, well, they might be, but once they meet me, they won't. No, I didn't tell him that. So one of these guys gave me the name of another guy. And he said, but you know, this guy, he's having a lot of trouble in his life and his walk. He's not doing very well. I said, well, that sounds like somebody I need to get in touch with. So I called this man up. I won't give you his name. Some of you would know him. It's not Mike Buford. Mike's always done well from the first day I met him. But I called this man up and I said, hello, blank. I'm Bob and I came here to start a church and so-and-so gave me your name and he told me that you're not doing so good in your walk with the Lord right now. And lo and behold, the guy said, well, that's right. And I said, well, I'd like to help you. And he said, well, okay. And he became a member of our church and is to this day a dear friend of mine. In fact, we were emailing just last night. He lives in another city now. So God can use even me. If He can use me, He can use you. But He's saying we need God's power. And then lastly, we'll wrap it up here. He said that the reason for all this is found in verse 12, that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, God, not Calvary Chapel, not Bob Grenier, not anything else, but the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and you in Him according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, if you will have God's power to do the good things that your faith prompts you to do, then the name of the Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live. You live the right way, His name is going to be honored. and you will be honored right along with him. This is all made possible, Paul is saying, because of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So I really want to encourage all of us tonight to, as we close out our service with the tithes and the offerings and our worship, let's ask God to give us fresh power. How about that? Fresh power from God to enable us to do the things that he's called us to do. And when you wake up in the morning, ask him in the morning, Lord, give me power today. You've got things you want me to do. Prompt me, lead me, guide me. Give me the power to serve you. So let's have the ushers come on up, please. Thank you for being so attentive tonight. I really, really appreciate it. It's a blessing to be able to minister to you. Let's pray. Father, what a blessing to be, in my mind, caught up in the Word of God and in the thinking of the Word of God, in the truth of the Word of God. We've just looked into our own futures. We've just looked into the future, unfortunately, of many people. And we see, Lord, that there is a power available to us, and we see that prayer is effective. And so thank you, Father, for ministering to us this very evening. And we want to bring now the tithes and the offerings to you and honor you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.